Understand the aversion to sitting in the middle. I just don't get it, but that's okay. I'm just glad you all are here, so I'm not going to argue that point very much. So welcome, and we want to welcome our guests and visitors today as well. A few announcements. You see the two that are printed in the bulletin. First of all, I want to wish all the dads Happy Father's Day, and also all the men who have served as father figures to others a Happy Father's Day, because you don't have to be a biological dad to be a father figure for others in their lives. I am going to be in Palm Springs Wednesday through Saturday of this coming week, attending to some family business. So that's the 21st to the 24th. And I'll be back here on late Saturday night. I'll be here Sunday morning, the 25th, leading worship. But Tammy has offered to preach for me that Sunday, and I'm very grateful for that. So thank you, Tammy. And I'll say this, as I've said this before, that especially given the difficulties I've had this year with some of the family issues I've had to deal with, it's been very helpful to have a group of people in this congregation who I can rely on to just step up and to fill the pulpit when it's necessary. So I'm grateful for that as well. Are there any announcements I missed? Peggy?
Yes, as we already know, that our church hosted a Presbytery meeting recently, and PW provided the compliments on the food, so thanks to all you ladies who contributed in any way. With that being said, today could be a good day to put the tables back. If there's someone interested in helping with that would be great. Except for the one by the door.
Right. This first one, as you go into the hall, we leave that set up for Tuesday night Bible study. So if anybody's able to help after fellowship to put the tables back in the rows, that would be great. And I'll tell you, Peggy, I got so many compliments. But I also made it very clear to the folks at Presbytery that if they left hungry, it was their own fault. So nobody left hungry, not to my knowledge. So thank you again to PW for all that work. Other announcements? Okay, I'm going to invite Bob forward at this time for a minute for mission.
Good morning.
Morning.
Father's Day. Father's Day is a holiday honoring one's father or relevant father figure, as well as fatherhood, paternal bonds, and the influence of fathers in society. The single most common date among world countries is the third Sunday of June, which was founded in the state of Washington by Sonora Smart Dodd. And there's going to be a lot of references here, and I'll have a short quiz in the fellowship hall afterwards. Father's Day is held on various dates across the world. And I didn't know that Father's Day was a global thing, but it is. And different regions maintain their own traditions of honoring fatherhood. In some Catholic countries of Europe, it has been celebrated on March 19th as St. Joseph's Day since the Middle Ages. Sikhs celebrate Father's Day on December 29th, the birthday of Guru Gobind Singh. In some Islamic countries, it is set following the months of the Islamic calendar. Father's Day is a recognized public holiday in Lithuania and some parts of Spain, and was regarded as such in Italy until 1977. And it doesn't say what happened after 1977, so I don't know what they're doing now. It is a national holiday in Estonia, Samoa, and equivalently in South Korea, where it is celebrated as Parents' Day. The holiday complements similar celebrations honoring family members, such as Mother's Day and, in the United States, Siblings' Day and Grandparents' Day. For centuries, the Eastern Orthodox Church has appointed the second Sunday before Nativity as the Sunday of the Forefathers to commemorate the ancestors of Christ according to the flesh, starting with Adam and emphasizing the patriarch Abraham. This feast can fall between December 11th and 17th. This feast includes the ancestor of Mary, mother of Jesus, and various prophets. A customary day for the celebration of fatherhood in Catholic Europe is known to date back to at least 1508. It is usually celebrated on March 19th as the feast day of Saint Joseph, who is referred to as the nourisher of the Lord in Catholicism and the father of Jesus in Southern European tradition. This celebration was brought to the Americas by the Spanish and Portuguese. The Catholic Church actively supported the custom of a celebration of fatherhood on St. Joseph's Day from either the last years of the 14th century or from the early 15th century. Apparently, on the initiative of the Franciscans in the Coptic Orthodox Church, the celebration of fatherhood is also observed on St. Joseph's Day, but the Copts observe this on July 20th. The Coptic celebration may date back to the 5th century, so this is a pretty old tradition. Whether to celebrate this day worldwide or not remained a debatable topic. In 1908, Grace Golden Clayton proposed the day to honor those men who had died in a mining accident in the United States. Though it was not accepted then, in 1909, Sonora Smart Dodd, who along with her five brothers, was raised by her father alone, after attending Mother's Day in a church, convinced the Spokane Ministerial Association to celebrate Father's Day worldwide. Are there any questions?
Would you repeat that, please?
I will. I'll do better than that. You can read it. No.
Okay, that's the danger of asking my clerk of session to do minute permission, because there's always going to be a quiz afterwards. Anyway, thank you, Bob. I appreciate that. Let's take a moment of silence to prepare our hearts and minds to worship God. We come into God's presence with gladness, for the Lord our God is good, and our God's steadfast love endures forever. Please join us in our introit hymn number 664, All Verses of Morning Has Broken.
Morning has broken.
Please join in our call to worship as printed in the bulletin. And this is adapted from Matthew chapter 10, verses 1 and 7. Jesus Christ summons us to answer God's call of mercy.
Christ gathers us and gives us power to be healed and to heal, to be forgiven and to forgive.
Christ gathers us to be freed from sin and to set others free, to tell one another and the world God's presence is at hand. Let us worship God. Please stand and join in our opening hymn, number 370, This Is My Father's World. Without a shepherd. Sometimes we are harassed by sin and feel helpless against its power. Sometimes in our sin, we use our own power to harass the helpless. We are wolves in sheep's clothing, innocent as servants and wise as doves. Forgive us, O Lord, and bring us home. Restore us to your flock and fold, we pray through Jesus Christ, our good shepherd. Amen. Hear the good news of God's love. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Thanks be to God. And as we have reconciled with God, let us reconcile with one another through a sharing of Christ's peace. The peace of the Lord be with you all. As we come to our prayer time, I received a text from Jana Meikle this morning that Todd's brother-in-law, Mike Sessions, passed really very unexpectedly last night. So she asked that we keep Mike and the family, Mike's family, in our prayers this week as they go through their healing process. Are there others, prayer requests, joys, or concerns that we can bring to God at this time? Bob.
Well, we have a joy this weekend. Our good friends from Nampa, Idaho are down for the long weekend to visit. And Jean is at home doing Jean's thing. And Joanne is here enjoying this community.
Welcome. Welcome, Joanne. And that is a joy indeed. Are there others? Tyler. Yes. What's her name?
Lori Jean.
Lori Jean. We'll pray for her. Thank you. And it's good to see you in church. If there are no other joys or concerns, let's go to God in prayer. Holy God, we gather today knowing that this is your world. We don't like the weather you have for us, but it's still your world, and we are grateful for it. We are grateful, too, to be able to gather here at this time in this place with the freedom to worship you as we see fit, knowing that that opportunity does not exist for others in our world today. So again, we say thank you. And Holy One, you have heard the prayers that have been spoken. You see the list that we will pray for today. And all of these prayers we pray saying, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God, we lift up Mike Sessions. Janet and Todd's family seems to be just beset with problems. So we ask your blessings on their entire family during these difficult times. We lift up Chris G, Richard C, Shane, Byron and family. We lift up Paula, Anne's friend Sandy, Ron and Connie. And we pray saying, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, we lift up Jim and Josette, Tammy and Doug, and Tammy's sister Deborah. We lift up Mark and the Pocatello congregation. We lift up Steve and the Malad congregation. We pray for Cheryl, Cody, Sharon's family, and Angie. And we pray saying, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God, we continue to lift up Kathy, Dagmar, Ken, Alicia, and Steve. We lift up Kathy Robinson, Billy Joe, Ross and Linda, Rossi, Dixie, McKay, and Damien. And we pray saying, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God, we continue to lift up the work of the Belize Mission. Victims of violence, especially victims of gun violence, as we received word this morning of two separate mass shootings yesterday. We pray for the victims of war and disaster. We pray for our country and its leaders. And God, we pray for peace in our hearts, in our community, and in the world. And we pray all these things saying, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God, we take a moment of silence to lift up those prayers that we hold so deeply on our hearts that we are unable to speak them aloud. And we pray these things, Holy God, in the name of your risen Son, our Savior, Lord Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Please join in hymn number 459. I apologize for the misprint. It should be 459, O Word of God Incarnate. Please stand. Our first reading today is from Exodus chapter 19, verses 2 through 8, and I am reading all three of the lessons today from the New Revised Standard Version. They journeyed from Rephidim, entered the wilderness of Sinai, and camped in the wilderness. Israel camped there in front of the mountain. Then Moses went up to God. The Lord called him to the mountain, called to him from the mountain. Thus you shall say to the house of Jacob and tell the Israelites, You have seen what I did to the Egyptians and how I bore you on eagle's wings and brought you to myself. Now, therefore, if you obey my voice and keep my covenant, you shall be my treasured possessions out of all the peoples. Indeed, the whole earth is mine, but you shall be for me a priestly kingdom and a holy nation. These are the words that you shall speak to the Israelites. So Moses went, summoned the elders of the people and set before them all these words that the Lord had commanded him. The people all answered as one, Everything the Lord has spoken we will do. Moses reported the words of the people to the Lord. Our second reading is Psalm 100, which we read quite frequently here. Make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come into his presence with singing. Know that the Lord is God. It is he who made us, and we are his. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him. Bless his name. For the Lord is good. His steadfast love endures forever, and his faithfulness to all generations. And our final reading today is Matthew chapter 9, verses 35 through Matthew chapter 10, verse 8. Then Jesus went about all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues and proclaiming the good news of the kingdom and curing every disease and sickness. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion for them because they were harassed and helpless like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, "The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, ask the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest." Then Jesus summoned his 12 disciples and gave them authority over unclean spirits to cast them out and to cure every disease and sickness. These are the names of the 12 apostles. First, Simon, also known as Peter, and his brother Andrew. James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John. Philip and Bartholomew. Thomas and Matthew the tax collector. James, son of Alphaeus and Thaddeus. Simon the Canaanite, and Judas Iscariot, the one who betrayed him. These 12 Jesus sent out with the following instructions. Do not take a road leading to the Gentiles, and do not enter a Samaritan town, but go rather to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. As you go, proclaim the good news. The kingdom of heaven has come near. Cure the sick. Raise the dead. Cleanse those with a skin disease. Cast out demons. You received without payment. Give without payment. Sisters and brothers, these readings are God's word for God's people. And we respond by saying, thanks be to God. So I'm a true news junkie. I'll admit that up front. And I'm one of these mildly disturbed people who has several news apps on my phone. And when you come into my house, more than likely you'll find the TV on and turned either to the local news or one of the cable news channels. I'll leave it to y'all to figure out what my favorite cable news outlet is based on what y'all know about me. It should not be a surprise, but I'm not saying it. That said, I strongly believe that Jesus came to disrupt and reform the religious landscape of his day, and that we, as followers of Christ Jesus, are called to do the same thing in our own time. And yeah, that can seem as being political. That can be seen as being political, especially when the church becomes complicit in perpetuating oppression. Now, one of the challenges I face as a preacher is to preach the gospel in such a way that honors my own understanding of what God is trying to say, while at the same time not going so far to the left or to the right that some of you all shut down and stop listening. Can't hear the message if you have a problem with the messenger. So I like to think that for the most part I've been successful in walking that line, and I guess you could say I subscribe to the Mary Poppins theory of preaching, in that a spoonful of sugar makes the medicine go down in a most delightful way. So I imagine that some of you are wondering what the heck this has to do with the gospel reading today. And I invite you to hang in there with me for just a bit, and I'll do my best to connect the dots. In today's reading, we hear about Jesus traveling around preaching, teaching, and healing wherever he goes. We see that Jesus, having compassion on the crowds, tells his disciples to ask the Lord of the harvest to send more laborers, because the harvest is plentiful, but there just aren't enough workers. Then, as we read in chapter 10, verse 1, Jesus summoned his 12 disciples and gave them authority over unclean spirits to cast them out and to cure every disease and every sickness. This passage is very familiar to all of us, or many of us, of course, and the traditional interpretation runs along the lines of the disciples being called to proclaim the good news to the lost sheep of Israel. As some of you may have guessed by now, I have a slightly different take on this whole subject. The assumption the writer of the Gospel of Matthew makes here is that the laborers, both those currently involved in the harvest as well as the ones who join the effort at a later time, have the full support of their community. Or, to put it another way, we're all in this together, so we'll work hand in hand and do everything we can to spread the good news of the gospel. It's certainly valid to assume that the overwhelming need for people to spread the good news of the gospel is going to trump any differences. But what happens when that's not the case? This week, my news feeds and my social media accounts were blowing up with the news that the Southern Baptist Convention voted at their annual meeting to completely ban women from being pastors in their tradition. They went on to disfellowship, read, kick out, 5 congregations, including Rick Warren's Saddleback Church, which, with 41,000 members, is or was the largest Southern Baptist church in this country. The SBC took this action simply because these 5 churches have female clergy. I was saddened, but not shocked or surprised by this move, as this is the direction the Southern Baptist Convention has been moving in for many decades. Now, before I go on, let me be clear. It's very rare that I feel the need to publicly criticize the internal deliberations and policies of another iteration of the Christian Church. I'm making an exception today because in a world that is in desperate need of the salvation that the message of peace, love, hope, and joy, which is offered by Jesus, this move seems to run counter to everything that Jesus preached about and stood for. Think about this for a moment. If it weren't for women preachers, we would have no knowledge of the resurrection. This move also seems, to me at least, to be a little bit of a self-inflicted wound, as it's been reported that in the last year, the Southern Baptist Convention has lost 500,000 members. And that's a whole lot of laborers who are no longer working the harvest. Now, some of these folks who left the SBC are working in other areas of the vineyard, to be sure. In fact, I know several who have become Presbyterians. However, I can say with some certainty that many of these folks who have left have more than likely given up on church and even religion altogether. And before we Presbyterians get too smug about what happened this week, let me remind you that it took our denomination over 200 years before we allowed women to be ordained ministers. And there are still Presbyterian churches within our own version of Presbyterianism where they engage in theological gymnastics in order to avoid calling a woman to serve as their spiritual leader. We still have plenty of work to do in our own corner of the vineyard, y'all. So, the obvious question is why? Why would a denomination that has been rocked by a massive sexual abuse scandal and is hemorrhaging members at an unprecedented rate, why would they exclude some who are in a position to teach and encourage others how to be laborers for the Lord? I think the answer lies in a misinterpretation of 1 Timothy chapter 2, verses 11 and 12, which reads, "A woman should learn in quietness and full submission. I do not permit a woman to teach or to assume authority over a man. She must be quiet." So, I've said this before, we need to look at context when we look at scriptures, especially when we take them out like this. This appears to be a total ban, right? And Paul is instructing Timothy regarding the church in Ephesus, which is being plagued by false teachers working through women in the congregation. Not all the women, but a few of the women in the congregation. Patrick Franklin, an associate professor of theology and ethics at Providence Theological Seminary in Manitoba, Canada, writes, "The women in Ephesus were being banned from teaching and leadership not because they were women, but because they were not ready and not adequately trained for the job. And given their status, used to be people of influence, and values, it's important to be rich and to appear affluent. It seems that they lacked both knowledge of the Christian faith and the humility and self-awareness to recognize their lack. Many of these high-status women probably had male slaves/servants who were now worshiping with them in the Christian church. The kind of authority they were used to exercising over them was no longer fitting in the context of Christian worship and community." Here, as Professor Franklin makes clear, writings attributed to Paul have been applied to the universal church when, in reality, Paul was addressing a specific issue within a specific congregation. Context matters, y'all. Now, I realize I'm preaching to a congregation that has consistently and boldly affirmed God's call to women in ministry for many, many years. And I'll add my own wholehearted and unequivocal affirmation to yours. I've been told that this congregation was the first one in our presbytery to ordain women as deacons and elders, even before the ban on such ordinations was lifted. I give thanks to God for your continued courage, vision, and leadership in following the voice of the Holy Spirit. I'll also note that I stand here as the first male pastor to serve this church in over 35 years. And if it had not been for the women deacons, elders, and ministers in my own life who encouraged and nurtured my sense of call, I'm pretty sure I wouldn't be standing here today. So where does this leave us? In a world where many people claim to follow Christ Jesus, turn and weaponize Scripture to exclude those who they don't like or agree with, we have an opportunity to walk a different path. We have an opportunity to consistently and boldly affirm God's call, not just to women, but to whomever God chooses to call. There is an overwhelming need for the message of peace, love, hope, and joy that the teachings of Jesus offers the world. So why would we turn away anyone who is willing to help spread that good news? Your assignment this week is to exercise your God-given gift to heal the disease and sickness of division and exclusion. Resist the temptation to use Scripture as a weapon against another child of God. And if that temptation rises up, take a breath. Step back and think about what Jesus would do in that situation. go and look at the context of whatever passage you're planning on using to justify shaming or excluding anyone else. The world's need of the good news of the gospel is far too great to indulge in the foolishness of division or exclusion. Amen. I'll invite the ushers to come forward at this time for the morning offer. Return a portion of your bounty that you have so generously given us to you to further the work of your kingdom in our community and our world. We pray all of these things with gratitude in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. And as we go out to be God's hands and feet in the world, let us join together with the Universal Church in professing what we believe through the Nicene Creed, found on page 34 in the front of your hymnal. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is, seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Please join in our closing hymn, number 331, God of the Ages. hear this charge. Just like the 12, each of you have been given the gift to heal sickness. Use that God-given authority to heal the sickness of division and exclusion, for that is the true purpose of the gift. And may God watch between me and thee while we are absent one from another. And all God's people said, Alleluia. Amen. Amen.